this is it. This is your moment. Like, if you've ever thought of yourself in a in like some megalomaniac constitutional moment, like, this is your moment. And you know, you dig deep. I don't sleep anymore. Like, I dig so deep. I work so hard. I mean, I'm in a car right now doing this because my dog got neutered and he's not really feeling well. But here I came anyway to do this event in a truck. And I'm sorry about being in the truck, but damn it, I didn't want to cancel the event. And so here I am. And just dig deep, and every one of us works hard. We can do this.
We are so excited to have you here with us to talk with the one, the only, Dr. Rachel Bitecofer. Before we begin, I just want to share with you a little about how we as a group of Biden Republicans are trying to make an impact in this election. And one way is through our digital campaign office. So every Wednesday at 5 o'clock, we are going to be making calls for the Joe Biden campaign into swing states, and you can be a part of it. Dr. Bitecofer, thank you so much for being with us. You are a senior advisor at the Lincoln Project, a fellow at the Niskanen Center, and I've known you because growing up in Hampton Roads, Virginia, you were a fixture of the political scene both throughout Virginia and especially in Hampton Roads. So it really is exciting to speak with you. Thanks for being with us.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I gotta say, it's my pleasure to be here and to be talking specifically to your group, who as a political scientist and social scientist are particularly of interest to me. But as an American, I'm so grateful that you exist.
Yeah. Well, and I should clarify, you know, everybody that we've had on the rally so far has been a partisan Republican for most of their lives, and now they're supporting Joe Biden for president. You are coming at this as an election forecaster and a political scientist, not necessarily a Republican, but I feel like your research and data and your work has so much to teach us about how we can speak to fellow Republicans. So I just wanted to put that out there at the very beginning that you're not a Republican yourself.
No, and in fact, like, my political identification depends on what I'm talking, like if your perception of it anyway, would depend on what part of like what you saw of my like shtick. Now that I'm on the Lincoln Project, because I keep getting these like hate mail from left, you know, people from the left about how I'm a Republican. And you know, but I'm very forthcoming about my political identity, like my personal identity. I actually have always kind of thought of myself as an independent. I think it came from coming into politics backwards, like where most people, younger especially, get politically engaged in high school and college and get into active, you know, active politics that way. Like, I was a total screw up as a kid, and I didn't do like any of that stuff. I was going to Grateful Dead shows, and so so I didn't have like a political party or anything like that. And I actually call myself, like, I think the nation's only never Trump independent, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, funny enough, you might find some friends that fit that category on this call listening to this rally. Well, I want to get started by talking about, you came out with this really innovative and groundbreaking theory about partisan voting behavior. The Politico wrote a big story about you in which it had a semi-misleading headline about swing voters and whether or not they exist. So I wanted to give you the chance to explain in your own words what the theory is, and then I wanted to ask you a couple questions about that on the top.
Yeah, I appreciate that. That was a soul-crushing moment when I knew the Politico piece was coming, and I was so excited about it. And I had actually told the Politico journalist how important it was for the work to be well represented because of the blowback. By then I was already getting blackballed by election Twitter, and I was like, you know, it's really important that this gets done well. And he, I think, did a good piece. And then the headline writer, you know, you don't get to control any of this stuff. the headline just could not, I mean, I almost cried when I saw the headline. So the headline says, you know, there's a myth of like the swing, there's no such thing as a swing voter. And, you know, frankly, only a moron would make that claim. And I've actually never met a human being that makes that claim. So, but in political science literature, it is well documented and well understood that over time period, partisanship, which has always been very powerful, has become more powerful, and that the number of voters who are in that independent mix, there's a big chunk of them who are called leaners. They lean Republican, they lean Democrat. That group has always existed, in fact, but those leaners now are much more likely to vote like partisans than they used to. So they're very predictively, reliably like partisans. And so we talk about in poli-sci research, that decline of independence. And then, you know, because of that, like the two things I really would have stressed about independence in my research is number one, that and this is really provocative, no one's ever argued this before, that the chunk that is swinging, that doesn't lean, it's about 10 to 12% of the electorate, not 30, yeah. Is actually fairly predictable in their vote habits, which is like, oh no, what do we mean? We shouldn't like have town halls about them and like divert the whole election like to the mysticism of them. So that's kind of provocative. But number two, more important to me, is that actually there's two swings of independence, and one of them is the vote choice swing of a group of the same 100 swing independents, but the other swing is their entry and exit of the into the electorate, and they actually swing in turnout quite a bit, and it has a huge impact on that two-party vote share. So that's a big chunk of my research. And then what your host is alluding to, of course, is this argument that I make about what powers that turnout. And in the polarized era, which in terms of mass polarization, which is regular people, like the polarized era goes back into about, you know, the 1990s, but mass polarization really doesn't start to be quantifiable in public opinion data until the late 2000s. So we're really talking about a very recent phenomena. I am arguing that negative emotions that people feel about the opposition party are they don't know it. People are going to say, hey, I'm more motivated. Well, actually, now they're just straight up saying it. Yeah. But up until now, they haven't been willing to say it, but now they're like straight up, I don't care about Joe Biden, but I want to be Donald Trump. Anyway, people don't really realize how much they're motivated by these negative emotions. And it's not just hate, it's fear, especially now, right now on the left, people are genuinely fearful of Donald Trump. And it's not a hyperbolic fear like, oh, socialism's going to come and make you have health care. It's like a real fear, right? But it is this motivating factor. And in 2016, because Democrats were not fearful, because they were not hating anything, they were very complacent, in fact, and they were very nitpicky, right? They kind of relaxed. They relaxed themselves in terms of turnout and on terms of kind of like indulgent voting in terms of like what we call protest voting. And yeah. It was just enough in like almost like a freak accident, really, for Donald Trump to thread the needle. So that's what my research is, you know, very loosely speaking about.
Well, I really appreciate that 30,000 foot overview for everybody that's listening. And I want to go step by step through that to really break it down. Where our group is focused on electing Joe Biden, but a lot of the lifelong Republicans who are crossing over to support Joe in 2020 have a lot of questions about what happens after November and where our political home will be, the future of center-right parties. I am an optimist by nature, but I'm also persuaded by your data, which is probably not very kind to people who are in the center like me. And so I want to tease all that out. So the first thing, the first question I had, is when you say there are, so we've seen districts that swing from Republicans to Democrats based on the election year. And I know you just explained that there, but can you just walk us through just another example to be really clear with everybody? What is it when one district votes blue in 2016 and then votes or red in 2016 and blue in 2018? Can you describe what's happening in that district?
I'm so sorry. You'll have to repeat the last bit of that. I was trying to respond to a complaint about the audio.
Oh, okay. Nice. I was just asking, when a district is red in 2016 and then in Congress it goes blue in 2018, what happened and how did voters behave in that district?
Yeah, no, so that's a really great question. So in terms of these districts, or you know, the electoral cycle in general, and we really did have two different electoral cycles for the most part going on. We had the House of Representative elections, where you have all 435 election districts up for once, and we had the Senate cycle, which is a third of the Senate up, and that particular Senate map, which really featured a slate of Senate elections that were particularly not good for Democrats. So they had the advantage of a structural wave at their back, but they were, I've somehow been made the host of the meeting. So I'm having to admit somebody, but I'm going to admit them. So they had the structural wave at their back, but they had this major like headwind they had to push against because they had states that are realigning towards the Republican Party, Indiana, Missouri, North Dakota, that they had to try to win, right? And so like the way the wave manifested there was, you know, maybe them instead of losing more seats, and they did pick up a couple that were, you know, Arizona's realigning to the left, right? That's how the wave manifested. But in the House, it's all 435, and there were these congressional races or seats or districts that had these suburban areas. And that's what my model knew, like coming out of 2016 right away, as I started to formulated the theory in my head, mm-hmm. I said, everywhere where there are suburban areas and a lot of cluster of college educated voters, right, there are going to be these massive turnout surges. And we're going to see turnout in that 2018 midterm. This is obviously myself having a conversation with myself in 2017 early. We're going to see a turnout surge that looks like 10 points possibly over the 2014 midterms, which had historically low turnout. And that surge isn't going to be just anything. It's going to be a surge that is, you know, bringing to the electorate more young voters, 18 to 24, more Latino voters, more African-American voters, more college-educated women voters. And it's going to change that underlying demographic composition of the electorate from what it looked like in 2014. Yep. And that those demographics form or inform the partisan composition, right? So in 2014, when the electorate kind of scaled back from the Obama coalition and Democratic, you know, constituencies kind of left Obama, frankly, at the altar, those electorates became whiter and more Republican. And now they are going to have these massive Democratic like constituency surges, right? So, and I knew that in the areas that was going to be particularly strong was going to be in places like Northern Virginia, right, Orange County, California. So, you know, it essentially, like, I was anticipating the polls, right? I knew eventually the polling would get there, but it wasn't going to be there, of course, obviously, until into the fall and probably, you know, well into the fall. And, you know, there was kind of like a front, like, obviously, like 23 districts that were very obvious because Clinton won them, even, and there was a Republican that represented the district. So even in a lazy turnout environment for Democrats, though the realignment structure was so robust for Democrats, the college educated realignment like scenario was so strong that a ready Democrat had carried it, you know, a Clinton had carried it. So to me, under my theory and model, those are all 100% going to flip, right? And then and that was basically the House, the control of the House of Representatives. But those were also the 23 seats that the other people were having a conversation about as being competitive. That was where the entire election was going to be, like the conversation was going to be, right? And so then beyond that, so if I thought, well, if all of them are basically done deals, then it stands to reason the wave is going to go much further into shore, like a tsunami would, right? Like if you had a storm surge. So then I was like, okay, well, where else, right? And so I looked for all the places that had similar characteristics. And, you know, Henrico County in Virginia went around Richmond and Orange County in California. And I, you know, developed a model basically backwards using the Virginia state legislative map and state legislative elections to kind of look where can storm surge grow out from there. And so that's how I know that it's not just some like a fixed pool of people changing their mind, right? Now, there is that, right? You do have in 2016, when you had the Democratic Party being the in party, and this is a, you know, really long, well-established, like, you know, part of political science, you get in party fatigue. Mm-hmm. So, you know, generally speaking, even with Trump being not a great out party, like, option, right, we look at what happened. Independents broke in favor of the Republicans, right? And it's generally speaking, this is, you know, another part of the model I end up developing. And I start to look back and I'm like, oh, okay, wow, that's interesting. Because even, like, you know,
and you're talking about 2016 here, right?
Yeah. And so, like, basically, what I start to realize looking back, at least in the modern era, is that generally speaking, the public's the independent part of the public that can swing, which again isn't those independent leaners, those people aren't swinging, okay? Those people, most of the time, and we can talk a little bit about right-leaning independents right now, because I bet you some of them are on this phone call right now, and they're swinging for the first time in a long time, right? And I bet you it has something to do with this pandemic and this particular president, right? But in general, leaners don't swing. So when we talk about that 10 to 15% of the pure independent swing, like it turns out they're pretty predictably breaking 55, 45 at least in against the party in power predictably, right?
So before we get too far into the leaners, because I have some questions that I want to dive in about that. You've mentioned we're actually seeing the electorate change because based on the cycle, you have voters of different racial demographics and education levels turn out. So I'm just curious, when someone does not turn out in one cycle, but does in the other, let's say college educated women in Northern Virginia who decide to come out for Hillary or for Biden in 2020. What is it that motivates that voter to get off the couch for that particular cycle and go to the polls? Is it advertising? Is it their media ecosystem that just really gets them scared? Is it someone knocks on their door? Is it social acceptability bias with their friends? What's making that person turn out?
I mean, well, like, you know, we can talk about additional people, but like the big amount of people that allowed me in 2019 to say that Biden had a structural advantage and it was probably going to let him win the Electoral College, and that was before a pandemic rolled in and killed his good economy and 170,000 Americans plus because of his ineptitude, right? The reason is because, you know, on November 7th of 2016, there was a non-insignificant amount of white college-educated women who had a perception of America that went to bed, you know, that night. And then, you know, as they moved into election night, about 11 o'clock, they had a big-ass wake-up call. You know? And so, like, coming out of the election, like I had told I wasn't an election forecast. I didn't know it was going to be an election forecast. I had no idea I was going to be doing any of this crap. And I was a first year lecturer at a little liberal arts college, But I had a class. I was teaching campaigns and elections at a liberal arts college, and I was telling my students, oh, yeah, no, I mean, all the models, she's going to win. It's going to be fine, right? I did say, you know, there's one weakness, though, that the Clinton team has, and that is this Bernie Sanders contingent of the party, which is not insignificant because it's the entire under 30 chunk of the Democratic coalition. Okay, it's not. Yes, it is these little like the wing nuts, but it's this under 30 crowd who have now lived. They didn't live during the Bush era. They lived only under Obama's era cognitively, and they, you know, they are basically like they are. I don't want to say they're like spoiled, but they're spoiled, right? And that's a weakness because they don't seem like they're getting along to go along. There's a, you know what I mean. And so of course, when the loss came, like the whole media oxygen went to, it's white working class voters. And like, of course it is. If you study realignment and polarization at a PhD level, then you're like, oh yeah, duh. I mean, white working class voters are not going to vote for a Democrat. Doesn't matter if it's Hillary Clinton or anyone else, right? So I looked at the data and I was like, holy shit. Like 5-6% of Wisconsin voted third party.
Yeah,
that's insane. Like the big number in we think about Florida and Ralph Nader is that big defection election where Ralph Nader ruined the election for Al Gore. Da 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 da. It's less than 2%, dude. Okay. Right. So that defection factor is a huge, huge factor. And, I go running around Virginia coming out of that election, and I am meeting person after person who is like, before this, I didn't even vote in midterms. I only voted in a presidential election. And now I run this grassroots organization, and it's got 1,000 members in rural, District 2 or whatever, right?
Yeah.
There
is something happening on the ground, that's for sure. Okay, and so I want to talk about the true independent voters that you discuss, and then go into the independent leaners. And so I heard you say elsewhere that there's about 10% of the electorate who are true independent voters. And then it sounded at the beginning of this call that you said even that 10% wasn't necessarily true. So if you can just explain to us how big the percentage of voters are who would really switch between parties each election. And then also, what can you tell us about who those people are? You've done research, you've seen into voters' heads in ways that a lot of us haven't. So, what qualities contribute to them being swing voters like that?
Well, I mean, one thing I really want to stress at is that if you're studying voters at the focus group level, then that's really seeing that like individual voters in their heads, which is a different way to look at people, but it is going to give you a distorted view of like what I'm concerned about is macro voter behavior, right? All right. And also not how voters think they feel or say they feel, but how they feel. So I'm a big ascriber to things like behavioral economics, right? Like because I'll tell you this, and this is, and I'm no better than any other human being, okay? Like there's a big ass disconnect between how I think I behave and how I actually behave, right?
Right.
So, and that's what focus grouping is about. I mean, there's certainly value in focus grouping, and there's certainly ways to do great qualitative research, but I am a known skeptic in terms of using it in the way. Here's what I'm trying to get people to understand. I ran a survey this week, donor funded 3 rural, CDs, congressional districts in Pennsylvania on this USPS issue. And, I could have run it like every other person would run a survey, but I didn't. I mean, I ran it like everybody runs a survey, but like the way I presented the analysis was unique. I mean, I presented it the normal way, but then at the end of it and the way I wrote the report, I wanted people to understand, like, here I am. I am in the congressional district in the middle of Bumtucky, Pennsylvania. It is literally like peak nowhere. Okay. Like, of course.